All right, welcome back, everybody. This is Derek Kirby from the Dallas Prospect, back to talk a little bit more Mavericks basketball with my dude, Big Game James from Silver and Blue Nation. James, how are you doing today?
What's good, man? You know, not feeling too good. Cowboys got knocked out this past weekend, and our Mavs lost against these Bulls. So, you know, hey, Cowboys season over, but, you know, hopefully Luka can get back soon and we can get these wins back on track with these Mavs. But other than that, I'm alive and good.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely a rough couple days, or I guess really just yesterday in general for Dallas pro teams. But yeah, the Mavericks are in a little bit of a funk to start the year. And it's weird because their two wins have been very promising with what you see and how they respond. And they can't find any consistency right now. And we're starting to, as we're now six games, I believe, into the season, we're, 2-4? And the issues are starting to kind of pile up where it's not just small sample sizes. You can see some of the greater issues kind of plaguing this team. Yes, Luka doesn't play yesterday because of a thigh contusion, but he's listed as day-to-day. Whether he plays today, I don't know. But it's definitely more than just Luka, and frankly, it's more than just KP, and that's problematic for this team as they try to get their feet under them in an already condensed season. So yeah, yesterday they dropped a 10-point game to the Bulls. Not great. They lose 118-108, and you know, Jalen Brunson went off, but other than that, there weren't, I feel, a lot of strong performances. And when you're down not one but both of your top dudes, you're kind of like, okay, let's see who can step up, and one dude's not going to do it.
Yeah, and I honestly, you know, I made a tweet when Luka was out, like, this team is really regular and average when our stars aren't in the game, and I was wondering where the scoring was going to come from. I already knew Hardaway was going to try to jack it up like he did. You know, I know he had 13 points, but, you know, just jacking up those threes early in the game, and it's like you don't have the inside presence. So it's like, who was going to really score? Now, you've seen Jalen Brunson come and get his start and drop 31 points in the game and three off his career high of 34. Brunson is a steady player. I mean, he's getting, I believe, 12 points a game already coming off the bench. So he's been a steady player for us. He has a smooth, under control game. But as you said, you need more than that, and more than anything. And I know I'm sound like a broken record and I beat this drum, but you need more inside help. Once again, Dwight Powell, nothing to show for, you know. And actually, I was loving when they put Boban in the game, because I told you I like Boban, but because of his size and, you know, the way he's built, he can't get those minutes. But I mean, he came in effective in that short period of time, getting points and rebounds. So once again, we still got beat up on the boards, losing on the boards. And toward the end of the game, when they put those bigs in on the Bulls, you saw how we didn't have anything to counteract it. We miss a shot on the outside and we can't get a second chance point. They score it, we start getting down.
Yep. Yeah. And there's a lot to work on off of that. On the Brunson thing, he had a great game yesterday. He started a little slow to the season, still a little bit up and down. But if yesterday is an indicator of him turning some kind of corner, that's great, because they need a little bit more oomph in that department. As for, you were talking about inside. Yeah, Boban gets 7 minutes, 6 points.
Six rebounds.
You know, he's effective when he's on the floor. Like, there's no doubt he's effective. 7 minutes, 6 points, six boards. Hard to be much more efficient than that. But the thing with Boban, and it's been this way throughout his career, he's just not able to play, like, extended periods of time or heavy minutes just because his size and mobility is just too constricting.
That's what I hate.
It's crazy that you got something like KP that's basically the same size, and yet he's – as fluid and smooth as a small forward might be.
Right.
So yeah, if Boban had even just a hair more of that mobility,
just a little more mobility, man, I'm playing this guy because this guy is effective. You see, when he comes in the game, he gets in that lane. You're not stopping him. And I think I was watching Stacey King said it best. He said, it looks like he's playing it on one of those Nerf hoops, and he has the Nerf basketball and he's throwing it in. That's what it looks like, because you're not stopping him. Once that ball comes off the rim, he's anywhere near it. He's so big and long. He's getting that rebound. He's just laying it right back in. It's so effective. It just hurts my soul that you can't use him like you want because of that mobility issue.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, we'd like to see more Boban for sure. I think he's certainly needs more than 7 minutes. But at the same time, it's not just the issue there. I think one of the big kind of things we're unpacking here, and I've raised this question a number of times, whether or not, you know, Dwight Powell, he's always been polarizing within the fan base, but it's harder, I feel like, to defend him now than it was even last year before the Achilles injury, because at least then you looked at it and you said, well, hey, in terms of rim running, in terms of being the role man in the pick and roll and how he finishes there, he's in the 97th percentile. How can you not like that? Of course, that's an important facet of the offense. Except then he goes down with the injury and KP has to kind of fill that role. Mm-hmm. And while KP wasn't used quite the same way in it, KP moving into the five, the offensive efficiency exploded in that case. It went from very good to like really, really good in terms of points per 100 possessions. So it's like, okay, well, maybe that's a little bit telling there. He comes back off the Achilles right away as the starter. He's playing basically the same minutes he played pre-injury, which is crazy to me because it's been like a calendar year. And we're talking about an Achilles. That's insane. But there's definite issues there. This is from Mavs Film Room on Twitter. The net rating of the Mavericks with Powell on the floor is 7.5 points worse than when he's off the floor. So hold on, let me read this here because I think I might have slightly butchered that. Let's see. He has the worst net rating on the team, -7.5, and the Mavs' offensive rating is an abysmal 95. When he's off the floor, so yeah, I did read this incorrectly. When he's off the floor, their offensive rating jumps to 114.7. That is a staggering jump in efficiency in terms of the overall offense. And it's kind of tied to just the one guy in this case. And I don't like to pin everything on one guy, but for the minutes he's getting and the struggles he's having, it's like, okay, so you're not at that 97th percentile you were pre-injury. You got to give us something else, right? Surely you're giving us rebounds. No, he's averaging like 4 rebounds a game. He's like fifth on the team in rebounds.
Right, 4.2.
Yeah, and this team is one of the absolute worst rebounding teams in the league right now, like bottom five, I think. Mm-hmm. I think the only team worse than them so far has been, I think it might be the Clippers were slightly worse. Like they were the only team that was like sub 41. Like the Mavericks are like 42 or something per game. They had 41 yesterday.
41.5, like, and we're ranked 27th overall in rebounding.
Yeah. I mean, that's
terrible. That's not going to win.
Atrocious. That's atrocious. Mm-hmm. And rebounding was a problem for this team last year.
Right.
But man, oh man, you can't step back like that. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like there's, and you pointed this out too. I'm just kind of building off that, not trying to make it sound like I had your point.
No, not at all.
But yeah, the interior play, rebounding, and the fact that they've had to address that multiple times already, whether we're talking Luka, whether we're talking Carlisle, this is a major Achilles heel for this team. And I was wrong earlier. I said Clippers. It's Miami who's the only team that's averaging under 41 per game. That correction comes from Tyler Adams on Twitter. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's crazy the difference in that regard. So this team's got multiple problems, and KP will help some of that. He's a guy who last year averaged for the entire season over 20 points a game and about 10 boards, about 9.5 boards a game. So yes, that will help. And Luka, when he's shown himself dialed into actually rebounding, whether part of that's conditioning, which of course it has to be, he's shown he can do it as well. You know, he's a guy who averages 9 boards roughly a game himself as well. Great. That helps, but that's not everything. You got to get more. You got to get more from Powell. You had to get more from Maxey, who's also never been a big rebounds total guy. And you don't play a Boban a whole lot. So it's kind of like, well, shit, what are we looking at here? Willie Cauley-Stein or James Johnson for boards?
Nope, because see, here's the thing. You got Boban playing 7 minutes a game. He's averaging 4.5 points a game and 3 rebounds in 7 minutes. Powell is averaging 4.2. You feel me? And then you got Cauley-Stein, who's getting 3 rebounds off the bench. We talked about James Johnson. But here's the thing. If you're not getting rebounds and you're almost dead last in rebounding, you got to score other ways. And what do? We shoot a lot of three-pointers. We're 6th in the league in three-point attempts, right? Mm-hmm. But we're 30th in the league in three-point percentage at 30%.
Yep.
So if you're not getting rebounds and second chance points, because we're definitely not getting that. We got out rebounded against the Bulls 47-41. They had 18 second chance points. We had 10. So if you're not hitting three-pointers, which we didn't hit in that game last night, you're not going to win those games. And then you have to be reliant on Luka doing everything for you. And then that becomes problematic for the team because you're not doing anything else. And also free throw percentage. We're shooting 74% from free throws. James Johnson, 55.6. Willie Cauley-Stein, 44.4. Dwight Powell, 68.4. And Josh Richardson is shooting good. Hardaway Jr. is the culprit.
Yeah.
61% from free throws, 39% from field goals,
yep.
32% from 3-point range, and he's jacking up 8.2, and he was jacking them up in that game. Dog, you can't win games like that if your stars is out.
Yeah. I mean, the offense definitely has major issues. This was the third overall offense in scoring last year. We've talked to death how it was historically the most efficient offense in NBA history in terms of points per 100 possessions. And that's great, but it has not been the case this year. And I know some people look at this and they say, well, what changed between last year and this year? Why has this happened? It's not because they traded Seth Curry. Seth Curry is not the reason this offense went from top three to bottom five. It's because they're not executing. Mm-hmm. It's because through the first few games, Luka's been getting his feet under him. He's only had really one game where he really, really looked like himself for an entire game, that I think being the Miami game. I would say other than that, man, like this offense is just really in a bad way. You talked about how inefficient the 3-point shooting has been for this team. And yet they're one of the top attempts teams in the league. They're really struggling in that regard. But I also looked at someone like Tim Hardaway, who you called out. He last year through the first month of the season, it was brutal.
Mm-hmm.
Brutal. Even the game I went to and covered in the locker room, you could tell he was like seething because he was in such a bad rut. He was missing threes and screaming F-bombs on the court. Like, he can get into these just brutal ruts. However, when he finally did break through last year, he carried that for much of the year and he ended up shooting 40% from three. So I think this might just be a bit of a loop because he is in a contract year, right? He opted into his final year of his deal instead of doing what I thought was the smarter thing, which was to decline the player option and take a long-term security deal because the Mavericks had already expressed interest in keeping him. So instead of going that route, now he's in a contract year. He has to break through, and maybe there's a little part of that that's mental and that's distracting him a little bit. But I think he will round closer into form. I'm not saying he'll shoot guaranteed 40% again, but I think he'll round closer into form to at least his career average, 35-36%, somewhere in there. And that'll help this offense, especially when you're taking 8 a game. Like, yeah, at some point, you're going to have to find something that's working for you. But I don't know, man. This team's issues, as much as I want to say the defense has improved and you see glimpses of it, you also see giving up 118 to the Bulls. You see
Zach LaVine going nuts.
Yeah, and LaVine burns us all the time, man. Right. Like, he's one of those fantasy trade scenarios people have been floating around trying to get to Dallas because he's like 25 or something ridiculous, and he's a great offensive weapon for sure. But yeah, it's the defense, man. Like, their two wins again, what, like 78 and 83 points, but then their losses, like 138, 118. I can't remember the other ones off the top of my head. 106 was the Sun, so that one was good defensively still. Respectable within the modern NBA scoring range for sure. But it's just like, they're not consistent right now. Mm-hmm. And you can't afford to dabble around too much longer before you start to put things together.
Yeah, they're going to have to put things together. And, you know, as I said before, and the thing that hurts us is, once again, size. I mean, we started that game, Dwight Powell was our biggest guy, 6'10". And with Luka out, you had Finley Smith, 6'7", Hardaway Jr., 6'5", 6'6", you know, Richardson, 6'5". You know, we don't have that size out there. And if you go against these teams and they penetrate to the hole and they're not living by the three and they're forcing it inside on us, it becomes problematic. And then if you don't have, like I said, if Luka's not playing, which we don't know if he's going to be playing tonight against Houston, they play small ball. But at the end of the day, we got to get these boards, dog. Like, I keep stressing it because those second chance points kill you. You know what I mean? And they can become demoralizing. And as you said before, with Dwight Powell, he's not offering anything. And if Luka's not in the game throwing in them lobs or basically creating offense for him, then he doesn't have really – he's not a shot blocker. Okay, right. We're like dead last in the league in shot blocking, so we don't have anybody that's a rim protector. Even with Cauley Stein, he's not doing that. And he
on the played, floor right now.
Right, right. And he makes goofy plays. He just makes goofy plays. He annoys me right now.
Yeah.
But Dwight Powell, if you're in the game, the two – I think he had a couple attempts where he was playing in the Bulls. They're not even respecting anything he's doing. So he just comes right to the hole, barreling to the hole, playing out of control because he don't have anything to offer on the offensive side. And if you're not doing that, get us boards. You're not getting boards, then you're in the way. And I feel like that's what clogs the offensive efficiency because you don't have anything to offer and you're not doing it on the court.
Yeah. I mean, KP, yeah, elite shot blocker, averaged 2 blocks per game last right. year. Maxey is a good shot blocker. His numbers aren't like leap off the page, but he is a good rim protector in that regard. But I get what you mean for sure. They're not getting enough of that there, and you should get more on that end from like a Willie Cauley Stein and guys like that. But
and even this game against the Heat, I mean, we play good defense. I mean, they were facing up, they were in their face, they was uh-huh. you know, switching good man. But at the end of the day, Tyler Hero, I mean, he was killing, he was cooking, had first 8 quick points in the game, and I was like, oh boy, he about to turn up. And then, you know, he ended up having a bad shooting game. I think he only finished with 12 points.
Yeah, Richardson hounded him.
So that was good. Duncan Robinson didn't shoot good in that game. I think he was his field goal, I can't remember his field goal percentage in that game, but it was terrible. And we needed those two guys not to play good because Big Bam killed us with that inside with that double-double. You know what I mean?
He was catching alley-oops left and
right. He was eating on the inside. So, but that's where you had a Luka almost getting the triple-double. It's like, damn, if Luka don't have them games, it's like guys got to step up. And as I said before, Richardson, I like how he's a good two-way player. But we need a steady guy on this inside. Cauley Stein got to step up. Somebody on this inside got to help us because it's going to be a glaring problem. I'm going to keep on beating the drum because it's going to be a glaring problem when we're playing these teams. You can get away playing some small ball or getting away with those and certain things. But if you're not hitting three-pointers as much as we shoot those three-pointers and you're only shooting 30% from three-point range, you got to figure out some other offense out there.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, I think if they get another guy to step up, like last year, even though he was
KP,
not
KP, hurry up and get back. Stop playing.
KP? Yeah, I think it's the Mavericks holding him back a little bit. He's year two in a 5-year deal, and even though he's been pushing to come back, I think they're trying to be as absolutely cautious as they can be. But the problem there, as I mentioned to Saad the other day when I talked with him, KP, by his own words, says this wasn't – none of his injuries have been non-contact. They've all been contact, which – it's better because non-contact means like, oh, that means there's significant wear and tear there, that the muscle's weak or the ligaments, whatever. But it's like, okay, well, you can protect a guy in terms of like wear and tear. You can limit his games. You can limit his minutes or his bursts on the court in a particular setup. Like, all right, here's 7 minutes here, and now we'll take you out for a few minutes. Here's a few minutes here. You can strategize all around that. When you're talking about contact, all right, now you're just talking about probability. Like you can talk about like how often they're like rolling him hard to the hoop and things like that to try and limit the contact. But like you're talking about probability. So I get what they're trying to do, but at the same time, it's kind of like, is there a way to effectively plan around this? Like if it's just contact and like shit happens when it happens and you just got to see if it happens, like,
right.
I don't know, man, but this team, if they can get their shooting somewhat into form last year, even though he wasn't an ideal third man, Tim Hardaway Jr., when he broke through and you had him, KP, and Luka cooking, Mavericks were hard to beat. They could beat anyone. They went into LA and routed the Lakers. Right. Like they got attention. And even when Luka was out, Hardaway and KP go to Milwaukee and they beat Giannis. Like they can do things.
Yes.
But if they don't have that third guy, this team is very, very mediocre offensively, it seems like, especially if you don't have multiple guys at least stepping up a little bit. Like Dorian Finney-Smith showed great improvement last year. He's had flashes, I think, offensively this year, but he hasn't rounded into form yet. He had a career best shooting year as well, I think like 38% from three. Mm-hmm. Staggering improvement for him. He was like a career 30% three-point shooter. And so it's like if you don't get that and you don't have Richardson, who I think because he's being asked to take on more defensively right now, he hasn't been able to show you like the full package offensively that he can bring to the table. And so I think he's been a little up and down as a result of that as well. Right. And really, you need him to be your third guy. And maybe he'll be helped out by KP returning and, you know, being able to be the third guy instead of being asked to basically perform like the second best player. But I need more from him, especially if we're talking about like max contract stuff.
A lot more from him.
Yeah. And to be fair, it's with him more than other players. Like if you're talking about an offensive guy, like Luka, and I'm not saying this to dog Luka. I'm just meaning like, if you're looking at like a deal for Luka, obviously that's a no brainer. That's happening. But it's like, okay, well, you're doing it because of what he does offensively, and defensively, you're just like, all right, we'll just keep working with him. He'll be maybe an average defender. That's fine. We accept that. Richardson, you have to look more than just the offense. You have to look at what he does defensively as well. Mm-hmm. And he is giving a lot this year on that end, and he's showing a lot of impact on that side. It's just the offense has been a little up and down, where you have games where, yeah, he'll have like against the Clippers 21 points and he has like 11 or 13 points in the end of the first quarter. That's great. But then they'll have games where it's like 11 points and he's only knocking down like two or three shots. Like there's got to be a middle ground there where there's more consistency. He's a career like 16 points per game, not career 16 points per game. That's his best year, which is his last year in Miami. I think his numbers need to be about 16, 17 a game as the third guy here in Dallas.
I totally agree with that. I even say, you say 17, I'm even going to 18 point realm, closer to 19, because we're going to need that serious third score. Somebody that, when, like you said, if you got a KP and you got a Luka out this game, Richardson needs to be coming in there. I know he dropped 16 last night, but he needs to be in a hardcore 16 where it's like this guy is cooking, not 16 when toward the end of the game, you know, I get 8 points in the fourth quarter where it didn't really matter. Yeah. You know, these got to be effective points that are really making the team put them over the hump during that game. Like Brunson was. Brunson kept us in the game because Brunson was balling. He was taking he was effective and he was assertive. He knew that Luka was out the game and we got to score points. And you saw his mentality in that game. And you saw how he kept us in the game by the way he was scoring. And that's what we need a Richardson to do, especially if you got a Luka out. We know KP is out, but if Luka goes out, that's the mindset that a Richardson has to have, especially at the two guard position.
Yeah, for sure. And part of that on why I don't have Richardson with like 18 a game, he's still going to be playing with Tim Hardaway Jr., who's going to take shots a game.
Yeah, that's right. Because he's taking 3.3.
Yeah. And nights like last night, he's going to go 2 for 12, which is brutal. And that's going to be an anchor around this team's neck, I think, a lot of nights until he finds, I think, kind of stride and crawls back towards that 40% mark or at least close to it. But yeah, there's a lot this team has to figure out. Richardson was 5 of 14 from the field last night. No Maverick shot the three well. The best 3-point shooter you have right now on this team is probably Maxi Kleba, honestly. 3 of 6 last night. I think he was great in the preseason shooting the ball, and he's been pretty great shooting threes so far early on. Richardson's been a little bit up and down in that department after a red hot preseason. But yeah, this team's got a lot they got to figure out. And as much as I would like to say that Luka getting back, whether that's tonight or a little longer, and then KP getting back, as much as I'd like to say, hey, that fixes everything, I don't think it fixes everything. I think it makes them a much better team where they're not going 2-4 through the first six games. But I do still think some of these problems are going to linger. Interior, toughness, rebounding, defense, that's going to linger. They're going to have to figure that out. It's killing them right now. The second chance points you called out earlier, and we obviously know what happened in that Lakers game, absolutely killing them right now. And until they can figure out how to address some of these issues, and while they can patchwork some of it with some of their guys coming back, I don't know that it's enough to completely resolve the problem. And so against some of these better teams, they're still going to have some of these struggles.
Yeah, it's like you said, it's going to be rearing his ugly head. Last night, 11 for 42 from 3-point range, 26%. Like I said, that's not going to cut it. That's not going to work. Actually, this happened to come on with the game, whereas Zach LaVine was just taking us to the hole at will. But, you know, we have to get that toughness. And I said, you got a Willie Cauley-Stein for a reason, right? You got him for a reason. Now, he needs to step up, and y'all need to incorporate him or figure that out. I do like how James Johnson played in that game against the Heat. He came in, I think he had like 8 points off the bench, 8 quick points off the bench.
Yep.
He was effective, had a couple steals. I told you, I thought he could get about a couple steals a game along with him and Richardson can get his steals up, but he's averaging like 1.7 steals a game already. And I like how he's already trying to get the enforcer attitude with the team. You can see he's being more of that. But we need more of that from a pal, not being the enforcer guy, but we need more from you, dog. If you start in this game, dude, you need to get more than 4 rebounds a game. You need to get more than that. And you need to be able to get on these offensive rebounds. He offers like nothing on the offensive rebounding side. You can't do that at the center position. I know you're not huge, but you got to offer something out there to make it effective, because we've been talking about, and I don't want to keep harping on him, but that's a position on, if you are starting center, you got to give us something. And 4.2 rebounds is not cutting. I'm keep on glaring and flaring on that. And especially if you can't offer anything on the offensive side, if Luka's not playing in this game, then they need to figure out how they're going to rearrange that. And that's where Cauley Stein's got to step up and offer something in the game, because when you come in, you're averaging 2.7 fouls a game and you're only playing 11 minutes. That means you're fouling and can't stay in the game as well. Come on, y'all.
Yeah, well, the thing you're not going to like about Powell on that front is he's a career 4.6 rebounder. The 3 years prior, he was at least 5.6 to 5.7 ranged in there, but he's never been a great rebounder in his career. And that's just the reality. Like, Powell brings a lot of positives.
I feel you, but I just hate how Luka, we got to rely. Luka got to get 9 boards. Luka got to get eight. You know what I'm saying? That you got to have, and I know what he was, you know, before he came in, we couldn't expect that, but damn, we got to figure out something, some way to get these boards together. And just like you said, it ain't going to be solved just because KP comes back. We ain't all of a sudden going to jump in the top 5 rebounding team because KP came back on the team. Right. Y'all got to figure this out and get more aggressive or get more spacing or something, but we got to get more second chance points on these boards, because we keep getting beat with second chance points, and it hurts us, especially late in the game when you don't have that size. You start getting tired when you only have 6'7", 6'6", 6'5", on the lineup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. And, you know, with Powell, with regard to him, he's 29 and a half, so he's getting close to 30. He brings a lot of intangibles to the team. Like, he's a good screen setter. I want to see a little bit more of how he's doing in the roll situation, pick and roll, which he was for a stretch pretty lethal with.
Right.
But yeah, his value is definitely diminishing. And I think the question is, do the Mavericks see enough that they acknowledge that, or do they think he's still playing his way back? Because it is fair to say a guy might need more time, but when you look at what his overall, we look at his overall production pre-injury, and you like, okay, so like the ceiling was never that high other than this one thing. So unless we see actual, you know, evidence, something to suggest that he can get back to that form, we might need to have a conversation about whether or not it's time. And I know how respected he is in the locker room. I know that he is, you know, with regard to a lot of the the registering players last year, the whole voice of the team around the protest and helping represent the team with regard to like the bubble meetings and all that, setting stuff up. Powell is pretty integral to that role. I get it. He's respected. But I have to look at the on-court thing as well and say, like, okay, you know, I don't have the number in front of me right now of what he's making, but I know he got before last year a new deal. He was in the last real batch of deals we issued out, which had some great value in there, like a Dorian Finney-Smith at $4 million a year. Are you kidding me? Like, you've got great value in some of these guys, Maxey as well. I think Powell.
Dwight Powell's getting $11 million.
Yeah, no, he's not worth that anymore. And that's what you got to look at. But the problem is,
he get $11 million.
Yeah, and if you're looking at that situation, you're like, all right, so he's averaging 5 points, 4 boards. And he's getting a steal and a half a game. That's, I guess, something. But yeah, he's not looking comfortable out there. Any opposing player who bites on the Dwight Powell pump fake from three should be cut.
Exactly.
Dwight Powell he's never been a great 3-point shooter. He's particularly, he's 33% right now, but last year he was 25%. Year before that, 30%. Like, he's had 2 years where he shot 33%, and every other year is barely cracking 30%, or it's in the 20s. You should never bite on a Dwight Powell pump fake unless he's knocked down like three of them somehow in the game already. And so it's like, yeah, like you said earlier, he does his pump fake and then he goes barreling into the lane, and he's been in the past decent finishing there. He's up and down this year. Sometimes he looks like he's just completely out of control and flips the ball up. Other times he looks that was a little bit nimble footed. That's nice.
Yeah. And he looked like the first one you said, that's what he looked like in that Bulls game. I was like, what the hell are you doing?
Yep. So they've got to address some things, because he is negatively impacting the team's offensive efficiency, as we talked about before. Let me see here. There was more from Mavs film room on his impact. He points out Willie Cauley-Stein, on the other hand, the Mavericks offensive rating is 129.9, and his net rating is a team high 35.7. That's really, really big. The problem with Willie Cauley-Stein is he's so up and down, inconsistent. He makes some boneheaded plays. His athleticism is through the roof. You see it in times, but he can't find any consistency, and he can make several boneheaded plays.
He can make our offense so much better.
Yeah.
You understand, Willie Cauley-Stein, when they got him, I was like, okay, he ain't really no offensive guy, but with his athletic ability, his shot blocking capability, his length, like I said, his extreme athleticism, I really felt like that could be a benefit for the team, and we're not seeing it now. I know it's only six games, but we need to see more from that. I didn't mean to cut you off, but we need to see more from that, because like you said, I feel like the team would be more offensively efficient with him in there because of the athletic ability he offers on both sides of the floor. It can make the team better because you can space a little bit better because he's so damn athletic. But he makes these bonehead plays and bonehead fouls, and he can't keep you on the court because you're fouling at a high rate and you're not playing a lot of minutes. You got to be able to do that so you can make the team more effective, because I think the team can be more effective if he can get some more minutes and offer some more things. Especially, I mean, damn, he's getting 3 rebounds a game and he's only getting 11 minutes. Dwight Powell is getting 3 rebounds. I mean, Dwight Powell's getting 4 rebounds, only 1 rebound better.
Yeah, and Powell's playing 22.3 minutes per game.
Exactly.
Cauley-Stein's 11.7. So if teams aren't respecting Powell's rolling to the basket, which was his primary value, you got to figure out how to change things up. Even if you're just cutting, like, fine. If you insist on starting him, fine, but cut the minutes back.
Yes.
Balance out the minutes in your front court a little bit. See what you're able to do there. Like, Carlisle acknowledges the team has had a slow offensive start and that's a major problem for them right now. All right, great. That's good that you have that awareness, but then why are you running Powell out there when he's giving you less than he's ever given you? Are you really that strongly in the belief that he's going to break through and you're going to see last year's Dwight Powell suddenly?
Right.
I don't see that.
I don't see that either.
I know, like, and this is just talking on the subject of Achilles. I know KD looks great to start the year for the Nets, but like, you generally, I can't really think of any prime examples of a guy coming back off an Achilles and being as good as he was. Mm-hmm. And it's typically in that explosiveness department where they drop back. Now, KD's like 6'11" anyway, so it doesn't matter in his case. But yeah, Powell, like, I don't see the explosiveness in the pick and roll. And it's like, that was what you did.
That's what his calling card was that pick and roll. And Luka dumping off to him, that was his role. And that's what you had to kind of hedge and play against on that defensive side, because he was a threat. You're not seeing that now when they run that pick and roll. You're seeing that he's not getting that lift like he was before. And as I said before, love the veteran that he brings and everything, his leadership, everything, like his just the guy he is. But at the end of the day, we need more. And like I said, you got Cauley-Stein, and y'all need to figure out if you're going to, like you said, you're going to start a Dwight Powell, then you need to shave them minutes back, and you need to continue to bring a Cauley-Stein in. And Cauley-Stein needs to stay in this game, but not with silly fouls, and show what he can offer so Carlisle can continue to be confident and give him more minutes. You get what I'm saying? So it's a trade-off, Cauley-Stein. If he puts you in the game, you got to show us something to keep you in the game and stop fouling.
Yeah. And one final note here from Mavs film room. They point out that the Mavericks are utilizing the pick and roll less this year. Last year was about 7.8%. Now it's down to just over 5%. And now by that nature, the kind of identity of the offense has shifted just a little bit. I know that's a small change. You're talking about almost 3% there, but it's still a facet that when you utilize them and you had a full health Dwight Powell, that was an element of the offense that had to be taken seriously. Now you're using that less, which is only further consideration to, so why are you leaning on him? But it's changed the nature of the offense now, where it's like, okay, try and spread it out and just have Luka drive. You're going to wear Luka down faster that way.
Exactly. He's got to come back and play defense. And that's why, you know, people understand, man, you know, you're being the offensive star and you have to come down and get scoring, rebounding, mm-hmm. assist, create for your team.
Yep.
You're tired. You're playing a lot of minutes, and then you have to come back on the defensive side and play defense. And that's why you see sometimes where he doesn't play as hard on defense, because, dude, he's doing everything on offense. You're playing all sides of the ball, doing everything. I mean, it wears you down. That's why these other guys have to step up. That's why our defense needs to continue to step up, especially on the perimeter side. Richardson, Hardaway, you guys, Brunson, y'all need to step up. Burke. Y'all need to, when y'all come off that bench, we need to make sure y'all really guarding that perimeter, because, man, Luka is doing everything. I'm not giving him no pass, no excuse on the defensive side of the ball, but come on, dog. When you are doing that, people understand you're scoring a lot. Okay, you can come back and play defense, but when you're scoring, rebounding, and getting the assist, mm-hmm. that takes a lot more out of you.
Yeah, for sure. And
rebounding.
Yeah, and as Ty Mavs points out on Twitter as well, offensively, that impact, as we talk about, you talking about how much workload is on Luka every possession and how, hey, he's a bit worn down and he didn't come into the season in the best shape, which is a fair criticism that we've had and expressed about
Definitely fair.
The Mavericks are 20th or lower in most team categories, except for free throws and turnovers. They were excellent at protecting the ball last year. They are fourth in that category in terms of fewest turnovers in the league. And in free throws, they are fifth. So they're doing good there. They need to get the actual conversion rate for the free throws up higher. Right. They need to convert them better. And they need to figure out some things offensively, because, again, this was the third highest scoring offense last year, the most efficient offense in NBA history. And now they're sitting in 20th or lower. Again, small sample size, six games, but something in there should turn some heads. And it's, again, it's not the absence of Seth Curry. There's more going on here. Because even though you got some new faces, the offense should not be this radically different.
Right. And also, when we were talking about rebounding and how they're bottom of the barrel, assist.
Yeah.
30th in assist. 21 a game. That's it. We're 30th in assist. So when you see those negative factors, you see why we're 2-4.
Yeah. There's a lot this team's going to have to address. And again, it's going to be more than just the return of KP. We keep saying that, but I'm almost saying it to caution people, because I already know what's going to happen.
Yep,
KP's going to come back.
Yep.
Be a little rusty coming back, even though he says he'll hit the ground running. I got to believe he'll be a little bit rusty for at least a few games. Mm-hmm. And then when things haven't resolved themselves and gone back to the way they were last year offensively within the first week or so, what am I saying? Mavs Twitter is going to come unglued within three games.
Right.
Then people are going to lose their minds and act like we got to make great changes. Like, we can't rely on KP. Yep. We got to make this trade, that trade. You got to somehow trade Dwight Powell for LaVine. Like, people will spin things into thinking like,
and just make us even smaller.
Yeah. But they're like, this guy's trash. We need to trade him. Well, then if he's trash, why do you think other people want him?
Right. Do you think anybody's going to pay him? If we saying, and he's, and look, you think anybody's trading for them numbers?
Yeah, let me pay $11 million for this. Like, his value, a lot of his value is already built into his experience and everything here. You can't just place that into another locker room, especially at the price he's getting, the value he's getting, and think that it's going to be like, oh yeah, another team's happy with this. Like, I don't know, man. They've got things to address. They've got things to figure out. And until they start to figure out some of these interior issues, they're going to continue to have problems. And I think the first thing in that, as we've said multiple times in this episode, they've got to scale back Dwight Powell's minutes. Might even be more beneficial for him to do that. You know, like, again, a year removed from the Achilles tear, maybe smaller doses helps him be more productive when he's actually on the floor. Because he had eight boards the other night in the first in the first half, and then nothing in the second half. Like, maybe the minute scale back is good for him.
Right.
But until they figure that out, and they got, I mean, I think the offense will largely solve itself, resolve itself. But until they figure out some of this other stuff, man, I don't know what's going to be the case for this team. Like how much longer these struggles are going to go on. I got to think like it took them a little bit of time to get going last year, but not too long. Like within 10 games, it felt like they had kind of gotten their feet under them and were running. We're getting close to that mark now, and I feel like they're pretty lost in terms of consistency.
Well, we're going to see tonight. Is Luka playing tonight?
Last I saw, he was questionable. It's unclear if he's going to play. He was listed as day-to-day with the contusion.
So, you know, we got John Wall and Harden and then Cousins. So that's going to be interesting because the Rockets statistically matchup, especially on rebounding with a lot of us, because they do a lot of the small ball as well, don't have a lot of bigs.
Yeah.
But so we'll see how that kind of goes, because, you know, they probably like pushing that ball up the court, which another thing I just want to bring up is, I mean, I love when we run and gun, man. I think we're a more effective team when we can get that fast break and get to running and use our assets in Richardson. And, you know, Hardaway is known to be good coming off the fast break, hitting his threes off the fast break. I definitely think we're a better team when we can push that ball up the court and attack people because we don't have the size. So we got to use our athletic ability of the wings because we're, I said, we got to like 5, 6, 7, 8 players in 6, 5, 6, 7 range. Let's use those guys on the, once we get that rebound, when we do get them, push that ball up the floor so we can get easy points.
For sure. But we'll see how it goes tonight. I don't know for sure if I'll be doing the post game tonight. I do head out on my vacation tomorrow, but I'll figure that out. If I can run it one more time tonight for a quick post game video, I will. But after that, I'm off the grid for a week. So there will not be makeup post game shows on games that are days old at that point.
Right, right.
But all the same, I think that'll wrap up our talking on this. I know you got work and everything. So yeah, thanks for joining me here. Always a pleasure to talk Mavs basketball with you. And we'll see what this team looks like. You want to tell them where to find your content?
Yeah, man. Just check me out on Silver and Blue Nation. Heavy, as you can see, the star in the back, Cowboys. But like I said, I love my Mavs, too. We're going to continue to, you know, let that thing grow. But you can check me out on my YouTube, Silver and Blue Nation. Instagram, Twitter is my handle, Big Game James. And also, if you are ever on Facebook, you can look up the Silver and Blue Nation on Facebook. My guy Ryan Humphrey is very interactive. He kind of runs that page for me now. And then my Big Game James page, if you like Cowboys football. Now I'm been doing Mavs basketball as well. So just check me out. And me and DDP, my dogs, gonna be collabing. Have a good vacation, man. Get that good brain energy. Take care of the little one and all that good stuff. And, you know, when you come back, we're going to hit this hard. And hopefully we get this dub against these Rockets, man, so we can get back to playing some good basketball. So Luka and KP can come back and get from the bottom of the barrel right now.
Yeah, for sure. But until next time, guys, don't forget to like this video, drop a comment below, subscribe to the Dallas Prospect and to Silver and Blue Nation. And until next time, remember, every legend was once a prospect.
Peace.
Listen.